Welcome to video 5A and module number 2. Be sure, if you haven't already, to read the detailed reading assignment posted in Blackboard. This module has 5 chapters, but we do not cover all 5 completely. So make sure you only read the parts that are assigned. Okay, let's get going. We'll start with learning objectives for Chapter 5. I have broken down, so there's not 8,000 learning objectives at the start of the module. I've broken them down by chapter. So we're going to talk about gross income, some inclusions to gross income, and then some exclusions to gross income. And this video is all about realization and recognition, which are magical tax terms. So this was actually assigned, I believe, in the last module. It's a comparison of the way taxable income is calculated, corporations versus individuals. And if you look, corporations, it's really straightforward. It's gross income less deductions is taxable income. However, it's a little more complicated for individuals, where it's gross income, and then we have 4 AGI deductions, which are deductions that come before AGI, end up at adjusted gross income. And then you have deductions from AGI, which is your standard or itemized deductions, and then your QBI deduction before you get to taxable income. So individuals are a little more complicated. We've inserted that AGI subtotal in there, and if you take 503, you'll understand why. Okay, so let's get to gross income. Gross income, defined under the Internal Revenue Code, Section 61, says gross income means all income from whatever source derived.
Learn it. Know it. Live it.
So that is an all-encompassing definition of income. There are some regulations that help us understand that. So the regs to Code Section 61-1A, that includes income realized in any form, whether it's in money, property, or services. And the regulations also tell us that income, gross income, means the total sales less cost of goods sold, plus any income from investments, and from incidental or outside operations or sources. So again, an all-encompassing one, but strangely, gross income is net of a deduction for cost of goods sold. And we'll see later on in this module why that specific definition becomes important. Okay. So when do you recognize gross income? So a taxpayer recognizes gross income when they have an economic benefit, they realize that income, and there's no tax provision that allows them to exclude or defer that income. And that means that they would not recognize that income. So already we've drawn a distinction between realization and recognition, and that's important. So an economic benefit is that they truly have economically benefited from the control or receipt or potential receipt of that income. However, borrowed funds, that represents a liability. That's not an economic benefit, right? You owe that money back, so that is not gross income. The realization principle says that you realize income when you've engaged in a transaction with another party, and that transaction results in a measurable change in property rights. So there's all sorts of forms of realization. For example, when you provide services to your employer, you realize income because you have engaged in a transaction and you have accrued compensation to yourself. Recognition means that all realized income is assumed to be recognized unless there's some deferral or exclusion provision. And recognition basically means you include it. It's included in your taxable income or your gross income. Excluded means you're never going to recognize it. And deferral means you'll recognize it at some point in the future. So let's do a quick example. So Bart buys 100 shares of stock in the Cheesecake Factory at $34 per share on July 2nd, 2019. And by year end, the price of that stock has risen to $40 per share. And so does Bart have income? Well, I think it's safe to say that, you know, Bart owns shares that have gone from $34 a share to $40 per share. He has an economic benefit. But does he have realization? And the answer is at year end, no. Without realization, there's generally no recognition. And this is based on, if we refer back to our previous module, the ability to pay. So if the tax system was going to tax Bart on the appreciation of his shares of Cheesecake Factory, the only way he could pay the tax for that appreciation would be to liquidate some of those shares. And so as a result, until he recognizes that gain, generally the recognition for tax purposes isn't going to be, sorry, until he realizes that gain, the recognition is not going to be triggered. If, on the other hand, Bart sells the stock on December 31st, now he has a realization event. The realization is he no longer owns the shares. He sold them, significant transfer of property rights. So barring any form of exclusion, that income, in this case a gain, is clearly going to be recognized.
Here's 1 week in advance.
Yes, I'm a slumlord.
Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team here. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team here. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now my whole team in. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the...
Okay, so we also have this idea of return of capital. And this really saves taxpayers from having to recognize income when it doesn't actually exist. So the gain from the sale or disposition of an asset is included in realized income. We recognize that now. The cost of that asset is called its tax basis. And the return of capital principle refers to the ability to exclude tax basis from the realized income. And anyone who's an accountant kind of does this naturally. But again, everything in the code has to be prescribed, and so there has to be some prescribed tax law that covers this. So basically, the portion of the proceeds that represent tax basis are excluded from realized income because they do not represent an economic benefit. Okay, let's go through this example again. So Bart buys the shares for $34 per share. The price has risen to $40 per share and he sells. So his amount realized, and that is a magical tax term, amount realized, and we will cover this more later on in this module. The amount realized is $4,000. That's the $40 per share that he sells it for times the 100 shares he sells. His adjusted basis is $3,400. That's what he paid for the shares originally. And so, of course, his gain, both realized and recognized, is only $600. And that's a function of this return of capital principle that says, well, wait a second, of that $4,000 he received, $3,400 is what he had already invested in that stock. And so his income amount, his gain amount, is only the $600 difference. But without that concept of basis, his gain would be $4,000. And we're going to go through basis over and over and over and over again before this course is done. So as a result,
learn it, know it, live it.
Okay, so let's go through some examples of realization and recognition. So Lionel Hutz is a lawyer, and his clients make the following payments to him for services he has rendered. So if he provides the client provides $1,000 cash, is that a realization and recognition event? Well, almost certainly, right? The cash has changed hands, and as a result, that is gross income. How about if the client gives him a check for $1,000? Well, barring any unforeseen weird limitations, yeah, that's gross income as well. Remember, it can be in any form. A credit card charge for $1,000? Yeah, you better believe it. That's going to be gross income. How about if someone pays him with a gift card? Yeah, sure, that's gross income too. How about if they give him $1,000 worth of chickens? Yeah, you bet. Still gross income. Or how about if they agree to repair Lionel's car and those repairs are worth $1,000? Is that gross income to Lionel? And yes, absolutely. How about if they simply promise to pay him $1,000 next month? Well, that's a little bit more difficult to understand. There's been a transaction, but have any property rights really changed places? It's just a mere promise to pay. And what we're going to see is we're going to dig in on this under the different methods of accounting and see that that could actually be treated in different ways. All right, that brings us to the end of Video 5A. Thanks for watching.